Story recapped here. Today I'm going to show you a 1998 fantasy comedy drama film called Pleasantville. Spoilers ahead. Watch out and take care. David and Jennifer are twins that attend the same high school. Both of them have varying interests and are not entirely close to each other. David is socially awkward, has few friends, and watches TV all the time. On the other hand, Jennifer is one of the popular girls. She gives a lot of time fixing her appearance to maintain her popularity. Among David's favorite television show is Pleasantville, is a black and white sitcom about the idyllic Parker family. The stars are George, his wife Betty, and their teenage children, Bud and Mary Sue. David spends most of his nights watching it and knows almost all the facts about the program, making him an expert on every episode. He plans to join the show marathon so he can win a $1,000 trivia contest. Jennifer invites one of the popular guys at school to come over to her house for the night as her mom heads out of town. They plan on watching an MTV concert that will air at the same time as Pleasantville. Jennifer and David both get to the living room and fight over the remote control. The remote eventually breaks, leaving both of them devastated. Apparently, their new TV cannot operate without a remote. The doorbell rings, Jennifer expects her date to arrive, but instead, it is an old repairman who is mysteriously just in time for their problem. The twins feel suspicious toward the old man coming uninvited. Out of nowhere, he asks David trivial questions about Pleasantville, to which David answers perfectly. This impresses the man and hands over a brand new vintage-looking remote control before he leaves without charging them anything. David and Jennifer resume fighting. One of them presses a button accidentally, and it transports them into the television. They end up in the Parker's Pleasantville living room, in a black and white world. David tries to reason with the old repairman through the Parker's old-fashioned television. But he insists that Pleasantville is much better than the real world that they used to live in. Without a choice and a way out, David and Jennifer are forced to act as Bud and Mary Sue, respectively. In their kitchen, Betty forces them to finish a hefty serving of breakfast before going to school. As they explore the peculiar town they are now in, they still argue how to find their way out. Weirdly enough, David knows what to say and how to act in the town because he is an avid fan of the show. A fire truck passes by, but fire does not exist, and firefighters merely save and rescue cats from trees. Mary Sue's love interest, Skip Martin, also happens to pass by the street, greeting Jennifer. In an instant, all her worries fade away, and she might just found a reason to stay and enjoy Pleasantville. When they get to school, David briefs Jennifer about her friends and introduces them from afar. He reminds her to stay in character and not disrupt the wholesome town. The citizens of Pleasantville are clueless and unaware that anything exists outside of their town, as all the streets circle back with no escape. While playing basketball, Skip approaches David to ask him if he could bring Jennifer out on a date. David tells him that it isn't the right moment yet as Mary Sue, who is now played by Jennifer, is not yet herself. Skip is saddened by this and goes about his day. In the school hallway, David persuades Jennifer to go out with Skip, even just for once, so the show's original plot remains the same. Back home, Jennifer gets ready for her date while David goes to the soda shop, where he works. His boss is Bill Johnson, a friendly middle-aged man who owns the popular diner. Jennifer and Skip enter the diner for their date and continue to get to know each other. She gets bored and asks Skip to bring her to the famous spot called Lover's Lane. David knows Jennifer too well to read her plan in mind and stop them from going, but he fails. Skip and Jennifer continue to have an intimate moment. She exposes him to ways of making love. Although Skip gets confused about the unfamiliar feeling that he felt for the first time, Jennifer tells him that it is normal. Worried about the consequences, David rushes home to check if Jennifer already got back. At home, George and Betty comfort David, as he seems anxious about his sister's whereabouts. Also, Bill visits him after closing the shop. While the two are having a conversation, Betty comes over to greet Bill. Both of them seem starstruck with each other as their eyes lock. Meanwhile, Skip drops Jennifer home. On the way to his house, Skip sees color for the first time, a red rose. Strange to this feeling, he admires the flower from his car. The following day, David enters the gym and finds the whole team gathering. Skip seems to be telling his teammates what happened the night before. David confronts Jennifer. According to him, she should not change the ways of Pleasantville and introduce their peers to things from the real world. She disagrees and says that the town should know about the things that could make them happy. While David figures a way to contact the old repairman through the TV, Jennifer continues to have the town under her charm and influence. Gradually, some areas of Pleasantville change from black and white to color, including mundane things and the faces of people who experience new bursts of emotion. Citizens begin to grow suspicious as colors continuously appear around town. One casual afternoon, Betty asks Jennifer what happens at Lover's Lane. Jennifer hesitates to introduce the concept of making love to Betty. But awkwardly, she goes on to tell her what it is. Betty tells her that George, their father, would never do something like that. However, Betty instructs that there are other ways to pleasure herself. That night, in the bathtub, she does what Jennifer taught. As she touches herself, she sees color. Oddly, the tree in their front yard starts to burst in flames. However, fire isn't something that exists in the world of Pleasantville. David calls the firefighters, but they have no idea what to do. He takes the lead in minimizing the fire. As a result of this, the mayor, Big Bob, awards him a Medal of Bravery. After the ceremony, Margaret, a schoolmate, approaches him and gives her the cookies she baked. This is David's first romantic interaction with a girl, including the real world. In the diner, David enters as he is ready for work. He finds out that other teenagers are waiting for him to arrive. They ask about how he knew about putting off fires, where he used to live, and so on. His stories amaze the ones at the diner. He even introduces literature to them, storytelling the famous novel The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. Upon telling the story, the once empty pages of the book begin to fill up. Pleasantville begins changing rapidly. Previously, black and white objects and people start to develop full and vibrant colors. Only the town fathers remain unchanged. The group is led by the mayor Big Bob, who sees the changes as a threat to Pleasantville's values. He proposes an idea to George about implementing rules by offering him a position in the council. George calls Betty to greet the mayor, but she hides in the kitchen as she starts to turn chromatic. David sees her crying and tries to help by applying makeup on her face, turning her black and white again. One day, David brings Bill a book of paintings. He starts to browse through historical and iconic paintings through the years. This sparks a new interest and passion in him. For the first time, David gathers his courage to ask a girl out. He approaches Margaret to date with him, to which she agrees. He runs back home happily until he sees the old repairman ready to communicate again. After initially wanting to leave, David feels a sense of belonging he lacked in the real world. The repairman berates him for altering the show so much. David turns off the TV, relinquishing his ability to go home to the real world in the process. David drives with Margaret to Lover's Lane, and flowers begin to bloom in color, giving them a magical view. The spot is entirely in color as lovers surround the famous area. Meanwhile, Betty takes a stroll around town. She stumbles upon one of Bill's paintings displayed outside his diner. This catches her attention, making her go inside. She sees Bill painting another artwork and asks him about it. He shows the book that David, also known as Bud, got for him. Bill realizes that Betty is now colored and tells her that she is beautiful. The both of them have a romantic moment, but they know that their love is forbidden. Jennifer seems to change drastically. In this universe, she prioritizes her studies and loves learning. Skip comes over and invites her to Lover's Lane, but she declines, which is very unlikely. On the same night, rain pours over the town of Pleasantville for the very first time. Lightning and thunder also occur, leaving the citizens shocked and scared. But eventually, they enjoy it. George gets home. The fact that Betty isn't there to greet him and prepare food disappoints him very much. This triggers George to meet up with his mates at the bowling alley and do something about the situation in their town. They have an emergency meeting about the unusual events, their increasingly independent wives, rebellious children, and how to address them. The following morning, Bill wakes up beside Betty, with all his art materials scattered in the diner. Jennifer wakes up and sees that she has color. George persuades Betty to come to the town meeting with him, but she refuses. Taking a stand, she instructs George how to make his food, and he is shocked to hear those words from a woman. She meets up with Bill once again at his diner. As the townsfolk and areas of town become more and more colorful, a ban on chromatic people is initiated in public places. The TV repairman tries to contact David once again, but he refuses to give back the remote and return to the real world. While non-chromatic teenage boys harass Betty, David comes to her rescue and shoos them away. In that instant, David turns colored as well. Meanwhile, a riot is sparked by Bill's controversial painting of Betty on the window of his diner. The shop is destroyed, books are burned, and people who are chromatic are provoked in the street. The town fathers forbid people from visiting the library, playing loud music, or using colorful paint. David, Jennifer, Betty, and other acquaintances visit Bill at his diner in ruins. They help him clean up and decide to have a meeting afterwards. David starts to grow into a leader, advocating resistance to the new code of conduct of Pleasantville, a list of rules and regulations preventing people from practicing their freedom. That night, David and Bill decide to paint a wall as a form of silent protest. Because of this, they are both arrested and brought to court for violating the paint rules. David and Bill deliver a heartfelt message in front of the citizens about freedom and equality. Suddenly, people in the courtroom change colors and Mayor Bob leaves in shock when his appearance changes. Eventually, Pleasantville becomes colorful and is introduced to the rest of the world. Main Street, which was previously a circuit that led back to its beginning again, now leads to other towns and cities. While preparing to leave, Jennifer chooses to stay behind. David returns to the real world using the remote control after saying goodbye to Margaret. He sees his mother crying in the kitchen, devastated over her life and her failed relationship. David comforts her by saying that life isn't perfect. Back in Pleasantville, citizens look much happier with enjoying their colorful life and freedom. George asks what will happen next in the park, and Betty admits that she doesn't know. When she asks George, it is revealed that Bill is actually the one sitting beside her. Subscribe to watch more videos like this. Turn on notifications. And leave a like, it really helps the channel out. Thank you for watching.